Welcome to a special edition of Game Time. I'm Mix Bustos with Denise Densai. Less than 2 months are left in the NBA's regular season. A couple of teams are already considered shoo-ins in the postseason while others are still scrambling for spots or a higher seed. The Eastern Conference features a tight race for home court edge in the first round of the playoffs.
And here for our discussion on the NBA playoff race in the East, our basketball analyst and blogger Enzo Hoopnot Floho and ABS-CBN head of data analytics Edson Guido. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining us here in Game Time.
All right. So, Enzo, I just want to ask you first, starting off with the East, Milwaukee is at solo first place. So what do you think? Do you think that Giannis and company can sustain this through for a solid home court edge in the East playoffs?
For sure. I think they have the motivation they need after, you know, dropping out of the playoffs last postseason earlier than they wanted. So they have the motivation to be able to get that first place, enjoy the home court edge for the entire playoffs. They have a pretty tough schedule remaining post All-Star. So it'll be very interesting if they can sustain their momentum right now. But based on what I've seen, as long as they stay healthy, nothing happens to Giannis, they should be fine and eventually lock up that first spot in the East.
What about the second and third spots? Edson, Toronto and Boston are kind of in a tight race right now, and Boston together with Miami and Philadelphia. But do you think this can, you know, maybe kind of switch places eventually, maybe coming in to the playoffs when it starts in a couple of weeks?
Well, I think for context, it's very important to have that second and third seed because you want to avoid that fourth seed, because that will mean a first round matchup against possible, because we have five strong teams in the West, in the East, and getting the fourth seed would mean a first round matchup against a fifth seed and a second round matchup against Milwaukee potentially. So these teams will definitely battle it out for the top three seeds, and I feel like Toronto and Boston will have a, if you look at the remaining schedule, it's a very tough schedule for both teams, more so for Toronto, because if you look at their record, they're 31-3 against losing teams, but they're only 9-12 against winning teams, those teams that are above 500. So it's going to be a challenging schedule for them the rest of the way. And if you look at Miami and Philadelphia, those two teams have a relatively easier schedule down the stretch. Philadelphia, they actually have the easiest schedule in the East, while Miami has the most number of home games remaining, and they have a pretty good home record this season.
So you're mentioning a lot of home games and home records. Who else here in the teams in the East will get a lot of that home court edge here in the first round?
Well, like what Edson mentioned, Philadelphia has a good chance to move up. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the Miami Heat. So I agree with him completely that those two teams are the biggest threats to the Celtics. And especially with latest news we have on Kyrie Irving, the prospects for Boston, it'll be very interesting. Of course, Irving out means Brooklyn's out. It creates so much tension in the East ladder. So the Celtics, I think, like what Edson said, because they have a tough skid, they're probably going to drop off. And then Philadelphia and Miami have the strongest chance of moving up, getting that home court edge in the first round. And hopefully, like what Edson said, avoiding a matchup with Milwaukee in the next round of the East playoffs.
But does it look like, you mentioned about the Celtics, does it look like Orlando and Brooklyn will make the playoffs by default, or as the other teams behind them are probably preparing already for the draft lottery?
Yes, I feel like Orlando and Brooklyn are in good position to move to the postseason. Because if you look at the other teams that are below the Magic, it's Washington, Charlotte, Chicago, and Detroit. Those four teams are they have the five toughest remaining schedule in the East. And if you look at Orlando, they actually have the second easiest schedule in the East behind Philadelphia. So that two-game lead in the loss column might seem a little manageable for those teams outside the playoff picture. But in reality, if you look at the remaining schedule, it's actually a significant lead for me personally.
When you say tough and easier skids, would you mean that going up teams against below that bar, below maybe 9th, 10th, 11th seeds?
We're actually looking at the cumulative winning percentage of those teams. So these are teams that are on average have winning records compared to teams that are facing teams that are have more losses than wins.
All right. So now, Enzo, I just want to ask, now Kyrie Irving is out due to an injury, season-ending injury, and you mentioned that they may go in the playoffs by default because as you mentioned, ends with Washington, Chicago, and Charlotte. Virtually, you know, virtually impossible for them to make it to the playoffs. But then do you think that other guys may step up eventually for Kyrie Irving and for the Magic as well?
Well, for sure. For the Nets, it's going to be very important for them, as a franchise at least, to be able to stay in that, even if it's in the lower half of the top eight in the East, for them to stay there and eventually make the playoffs, that's still a big step forward for them. Remember that when they got Kyrie, when they got KD in the offseason, they wanted to build around those players. And making it to the playoffs, heading into next season, even if they have a very small chance of winning anything in the playoffs for this particular summer, making it to the, you know, to the playoffs, that's good momentum in the offseason and into next season, when hopefully, both Kyrie and KD will be healthier and they can set themselves up for even more success. So that's going to be crucial for Brooklyn.
And to your point, Enzo,
I think Brooklyn earlier this season had a good winning streak with Kyrie Irving actually out, with Dinwiddie leading the charge for the Nets. So I feel like in their last game against Philadelphia, it was a close game, but when we look at the numbers, Dinwiddie and Caris LeVert really stepped up in their first game without Kyrie Irving.
Now, speaking of heading into the next season, how agreeable did you find the Hawks' new move by, you know, grabbing Clint Capela to prepare them for the next one?
Well, that's very interesting. I mean, Capela has been a solid center, you know, when he was with Houston. It'll be interesting to see how they utilize him in Atlanta moving forward. Is he going to be their main guy? Bar none. We don't know yet. How is he going to mesh with Trae Young moving forward? That's going to be a very interesting dynamic, Denise. And if they want to build around those two young guys, that's promising. But it remains to be seen if they are actually good enough to carry that team to greater heights heading into next season.
Quick predictions, guys. Enzo and Edson, your top three.
Ooh.
Top three guys for the East heading into the playoffs.
Top three teams into the playoffs.
Yes.
Milwaukee's a lock for me at number one. I don't think the Raptors will drop off further down. I mean, lower than three. So they're in the top three for sure. My third, I'm not sure if Edson will agree, I'm actually putting my money on Eric Spoelstra's Miami Heat to move up. So
interesting.
I hope. Eric Spoelstra, our Kababayan. Hopefully, he gets them to that top three. So that's Milwaukee, that's Toronto, and Miami.
I'd have to go with Milwaukee, Miami also, and then my third pick would be Boston.
Wow.
Ooh, okay.
So you agreed with Miami, but you're going with Boston over
instead
Toronto.
Of Toronto. Because the difference between those two teams is Boston so far this season has proven that it can win against teams that have superior record. Uh-huh. The Raptors have a lot of games left against teams with winning records that they actually lost to earlier in the season. They have games against Milwaukee. They have three games left against Milwaukee, if I remember correctly. So it's going to be a tough schedule for them down
exciting.
The stretch. Yeah, exciting.
Right. If earlier we had the East, now it's time to shift to the West. Enzo, what do you think of LA shoe-in for number one?
I think so. They have a 5-game lead in the loss column against Denver and the Clippers, and the remaining schedule isn't really that tough for them. And I feel like the Lakers have shown this season that they're really a good road team as well. So that's very important moving forward.
Unlike in the East, wherein you have maybe a close records from 2-3, but with the second to fifth place, more or less, they have maybe 1-2 games behind each other. And so, do you think that more or less you can be able to mix this up? This will still be jumbled in the end of the regular season.
For sure, Migs. I mean, it's very, how shall I say it, nebulous. Parang you can't really see who has a lock yet, save for, like what Edson said, the Lakers, who should be at number one from this point until the end of the regular season. But you look at the Nuggets, the Clippers, you look at Utah, Houston even, and they're all bunched up there with 1-2 wins separating all those teams. And with so much at stake in the Western Conference, where arguably it's a deeper conference, so many things can still happen. I wouldn't be surprised if, let's say, Denver goes on a losing streak and moves down a little bit. I wouldn't be surprised also if the Clippers move up as well. The Clippers, I think, Edson can correct me on this, but I think they also have maybe the fifth or sixth easiest record in the West.
Yes.
So they actually have a pretty good shot of maybe climbing pa, maybe reaching that number two spot in the West. For the other teams, it's going to be a little harder, I think. But like what you said, Migs, it's so difficult to see who's a lock for 2, 3, 4, 5 in that Western Conference with so many teams that are separated by so few wins and with other teams in the bottom half of that set who have the potential also to move up.
But gentlemen, do you think with the Clippers' latest acquisition of, you know, Marcus Morris and Reggie Jackson, do you think that will put an edge to the arms race between the LA Lakers?
Well, it's interesting how the approach of the Clippers is. They're really trying to build around Kawhi Leonard, I think, with a lot more pieces. But I'm not sure if putting these two guys in, who are pretty good offensively, they're explosive offensively, if that's the ticket for them to eventually beat the Lakers if they face them in the playoffs. I think the Clippers are good enough to beat any team in the first round, any team they can potentially face. But if they meet the Lakers in the second round, if they meet them in the third round, the Western Conference Finals, that is the matchup for them. That's the matchup they should be preparing for. I'm not convinced that getting those two guys increases their chances significantly against the Lakers.
Edson, do you agree or disagree?
I think in terms of getting Marcus Morris and Reggie Jackson, these are two pieces that would potentially have helped the Lakers more. It's more of like getting these pieces just to prevent the Lakers from getting those two. Yeah. But if you look at the depth chart of the Clippers, Reggie Jackson for me is probably the fourth guard on their rotation behind Lou Williams, Pat Beverly, and Landry Shamet, who's been a lights-out shooter for the Clippers. But Morris, I think, helps them in terms of that having that extra defender against LeBron. And he's an improvement over Mo Harkless, definitely. So I think in terms of possible impact, I like the Morris acquisition more than the Reggie Jackson.
All right, so I'll just get a little bit of Filipino touch. You mentioned Kababayan Eric Spoelstra with the Miami Heat, potentially maybe going for the top three, but then Jordan Clarkson's move to Utah, he's been hot. So what can you say about Jordan Clarkson now having a different role with much help with Donovan Mitchell and Rudy Gobert?
I think that was a sneaky good move by the Utah Jazz to get someone like Clarkson, who's proved to be a very, very good second unit leader for that team. Of course, once you get into the deep waters of the season with more at stake, that's where the real tests are going to begin for Utah. For me, the question is, do they have enough experience and mental toughness to stay in that top four in that Western Conference? For me, that's crucial. Whichever, goes below that top four, I think their chances of advancing in the postseason are significantly diminished already. Because the West is just so stacked and so deep, home court, I think, is going to be so crucial in the playoffs. So for Utah, that's huge. If Jordan Clarkson can sustain his production, his productivity with that second unit of Utah, that makes him so much more dangerous moving forward.
Should this be a lock-in for OKC, Dallas, Memphis, at least in the bottom half of the standings? But who do you think can swoop in, at least for Portland, San Antonio, New Orleans, maybe? Can they make, what do you think of those thoughts, maybe coming in to the bottom half of the West?
I think OKC and Dallas are relatively safe. They have their postseason ticket for me punched in already. But if you look at Memphis, they currently have five-game lead in the loss column over the Spurs and the Trailblazers. But they actually have the toughest remaining schedule. With that, I mean they have 6 out of their remaining 28 games. 16 of those games are against teams that are above 500. So these are teams with winning records. Yeah. And 16 out of their 28 remaining games are on the road. And if you look at their record this season against winning teams, they're actually just 7-16. So they have there's a difference of 10 games in the loss column. So, and if you look at the Spurs, the Trailblazers, and the Pelicans, two teams in the West that actually have the easiest remaining schedule are actually the Pelicans and the Trailblazers. My only concern with the Portland Trailblazers is that Dame Lillard is currently injured. So that's probably going to cost them a few games. But for the Pelicans, they have a chance to really inch up closer to the Memphis Grizzlies. And I feel like this is also going to be a good subplot in the Rookie of the Year race between Ja Morant and Zion Williamson, because I feel like Zion is gonna, he just, before the All-Star break, he was able to set his career high in scoring in 2 straight games. So it's a very exciting future for Zion for me.
Wow, so now as we wrap this up in the West, who are your top 3 teams that you think will make it for the playoffs?
Oh, man.
Another hard prediction.
For me, that's harder for me. I'm going to go out on a limb. The Lakers are going to be there for sure. I'm going to go out on a limb and say the Clippers are going to be number 2 eventually. And I'm gonna be a homer and pick Jordan Clarkson and the Jazz.
Hipster pick.
That third spot right there. A lot of people will not agree. I'm not sure if Edson would agree, but those are my picks. Both LA teams and the Jazz.
Okay. Well, for me, the Lakers and the Clippers will meet in the Western Conference Finals. That's my pick. Yeah. Those two teams are just too talented. I think they're a notch above the rest of the other Western teams. For me, the third team doesn't really matter for me.
If you were the big answer, one, man. If you were
come
the
on,
big one,
I'll probably I'll go with Houston. I feel like they still have a run in them. They're going all in with that small ball.
Yeah.
They have the most Eastern Conference opponents remaining in their schedule, and they actually won 12 out of their last 13 games against those Eastern Conference teams because they had a good one against the Celtics,
yeah,
a team that doesn't really have that height down low, and they were able to maximize their small ball. So I feel like Houston, James Harden will have one more hot streak in this regular season. Westbrook is playing really well the past few games, and I feel like Houston will probably get the third
All right,
spot.
So Lakers and Clippers and the Jazz and the Rockets. So we'll see. Just a few more weeks away until we enter the NBA playoffs. Enzo Flojo, Edson Guido, thank you so much for your time here on
Thanks for having us.
And that's all we have for today, sports fans. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. I'm Mix Bustos, on call and always ready for game time.